gentlemen. Thank you very much. If I sum up the argument, it's not that we're bad Europeans, but we're not Europeans at all, according to Mr. Server Schreiber. And Geoffrey Rippon says that everyone else is out of step bar us at the moment, I think. We've talked about the war. Air Vice Marshal Bennett, you had some small experience of the war, I think. Perhaps on that basis you might kick off for us.
I'm delighted that Geoffrey Rippon should mention the war. We did prove that we were good Europeans, and we fought for freedom and independence, and we won. When France and Belgium and Holland were invaded, we came to their aid, and we successfully re-established independent national sovereignty. And that is the important thing. Independent national sovereignty, not ruled by a bureaucrat in Brussels, but ruled by our own parliament at Westminster, and similarly in the European countries. That's what we fought for. Now, in this funny mixed-up world, I don't know whether I'm opposed to or supporting the resolution. We are good Europeans by being bad Europeans. This is the important thing. We are for the good of Europe, trying to recreate their own independence and freedom. They can do as they wish, but we want to be free. 2-1 on public opinion polls today say that we want to get out of the Treaty of Rome. Not to get out of being good neighbors in Europe, but to get out of the compulsion of the Treaty of Rome and the insanity of the common agricultural policy. Even Mr. Rippon's leader has denounced the, shall we call them anomalies, stupidities, if you like, of the common agricultural policy, the way it's calculated, the results, like supporting Russia with cheap butter, while at the same time we won't let our athletes go to the Olympic Games. It's absolute nonsense, and we all know it. It's about time we recognized it and got out. That would be a good European. Then the nations of Europe would be free to do as they wish.
I'll take Mr. Wisrich next to you, who's been shaking his head most vigorously throughout your contribution, sir.
It is perfectly true that opinion polls today show that by 2-1, the majority of the British don't like the community as it is. But the same opinion polls equally show that when faced with the question, do we want a Western European Union, 2-1 are in favor of it. And when the question is put, do we want integration to proceed faster or at the same rate as against those who want to slow it down, more than 70% of the British want European integration.
Mr. Wisrich, can I just ask you, are we good Europeans?
We are better Europeans than many imply. We are good Europeans because we want a Europe united instead of messing about with the sort of arguments which we face in the community today. It is the community which is wrong at the moment. We want to make it better, and we want to unite Europe.
Mademoiselle Bischoff at the back there, you joined us a little late, hot foot from Holland.
Well, I think I would like to broaden the scope a bit. I think British foreign policy as a whole is not what we expect of it. The argument is now only about good or bad Europeans, and people are stating that the European community is that bad. I can't believe that because the British knew what they entered. And I think it was for political more than for economic reasons than they entered the community. And if you look at the rest of their foreign policies, let's say development policies towards poorer countries in the world, that's a poor show. UN policies, of course, the Zimbabwe deals accepted. A poor show. So I think if you talk about British attitude in the community, you can't limit that scope too much. I think it is a wider scope. As you know, we as the Dutch favored the British entry into community since 1957. And I think we wanted Britain to be a sort of countervailing power to the French. They were less anti-United States, one could say. They were traditionally more free trade oriented than the French. But now people in our country are starting to have doubts recently. And I think the main cause is that the British didn't live up to our expectations. I'll give you some examples. We had the renegotiation in 1975, which was just discussed. Then we had a sort of controversies between the eight and the UK on fisheries, energy, agriculture policy. And in a few points, they were right, of course, but transport, consumer protection, institutions of the community, and so on and so on. And now you have the budget question, and the British refuse to open up a lot of the other problems we have. Well, why don't we go as far as Monsieur Chirac in France, and then I say who's blaming whom, of course, by being not very European. We don't advocate a sort of expulsion from the British, from the community, but we think that, well, I know the British won't let themselves be forced into anything, and certainly not by the Dutch, but I think it would be a good idea if the British would discuss their entire foreign policy. Because if you are freed Britain, then many of your economists plead for a sort of protectionist way, which in short term will give some economic benefits.
Thank you very much indeed. You're not going to expel us, but make us stand in the corner for a little while, I think. Mr. Geek, I think.
Yes, I'm sitting here with my blood boiling, sir. That word bad is all wrong. Do they know what bad means? Worthless, inefficient, of poor quality. No British person is like that. My blood of my children looked like being shed in Europe for the third time, like the blood of my father and the blood of the French fathers and French children, and it's just not on. The Russians must be laughing at us, arguing about butter and things like that when they're ready to roll a load of tanks over us. And talk about bad Europeans. Bad is wrong. Let's talk about the French being bad Europeans. They've opted out of NATO. They don't want to know about their responsibility for NATO. De Gaulle, as much as I respect him, and I respect the French nation in many ways, I've taken thousands of French visitors around London, and nobody's ever said, we are bad. It's a manufactured statement which bears analysing. Now then, if you look into what we've done...
Can you analyse it quickly for me, Mr. Geek?
My father and my family and the French fathers and family have shed blood, and we don't intend shedding a third time when the Russians move. So let's forget about butter mountains and all these pettifogging details and get ready and face up the challenge in the East. And remember, as a last resource, that France came to us and we went to France to achieve the finest technological achievement of the whole world, Concorde. And once we work in unison with them and make allowances as I have done for their arrogance and their short-sightedness, then you'll find that the British can get on with. But what they can't understand, the British have got guts and they're not going to go to creep to any European gathering, Brussels or otherwise, to say, yes, sir.
All right, thank you very much. Guts and humility, no doubt. Could I have Mrs. Xavier, perhaps, as a Frenchman, would you like to respond to that?
Well, I'm very surprised to hear all this, because I think we're not talking about the same Europe. I would like to state at first that, as a Gaullist, I thought always that Britain coming into the common market would be a bad thing for Britain and for the common market. Now you're in it, and all we want as friends is to help you and to make the best association we can. I believe you are good political European. That means there is no possible political Europe without Britain. That is stupid thinking that we can say we are European, talking for Europe if Britain is not in. But I think you're very bad customers inside the economical association we are trying to do with Europe. Because I heard all of you gentlemen, no one answered what Jean-Claude Servan-Schreiber said about the price of butter in New Zealand or things like that. I think what you are now confusing is the big aims that has led you to join Europe and the small little things that you have to pay to stay in it. Because after all, first you accepted yourself, you accepted the whole plans when you came in. Second, we tell you, if you want to avoid paying so much, well, change your the shops where you buy your things, and then everything will be all right. It's not our problem, it's yours. And third, you tell us the French don't want to listen to any bargaining about the agricultural policy.
But the agricultural policy is the fruit of a bargaining of France with the rest of the community. We gave industrial advantages against agricultural.
Let me stay with agricultural policy. Hugh Lowe, you were a sheep farmer. You were waiting to come in there, I saw, shaking your head, as was Theresa Wickham in front of you, who's an apple grower. Let's hear from a farmer first. Yes.
Yes, indeed. I think that Mr. Servan Schreiber, in fact, made my point better than I'm going to make it myself. He accused us of thinking short term and of not being good Europeans. And in fact, he then went on about the New Zealanders buying cars and butter and so forth. I think it's the humbug which we always see, which seems to be a thread right through any statements which come from anywhere in France, which makes us even crosser than we otherwise would be. We wouldn't mind. Possibly one could tolerate one's living being damaged, as my living is being damaged as a sheep producer. I'm selling my lamb now for less money than I was selling it 12 months ago, and I expect to go on doing so, all the while the French, who were dragged kicking and screaming to the court, and then finally were told that they should accept our lamb. In fact, they still resisted. They accuse us of breaking the rules, and then even when they get to court, they still don't keep the rules. Okay. And as far as I'm concerned, it's the humbug. I don't mind what they do, but it's the humbug which they seem to feel we have
Let's
to take
have
as well.
A word on humbug, perhaps, Mr. Servan Schreiber?
I want to comment on this word, because I think that it's much deeper than you feel. We can say the same thing about our wine producers, about our cattle breeders, and so on. And we can also say that the British make a lot of humbug about it all, but it's not that that I wanted to. It's not the point that I wanted to make. I think it's much more serious than this. It's on a higher level.
I'll come back to you in that case. But these are things that people care about. Let me, Theresa Wickham, apples.
Yes, I'm delighted you bypass it by putting on a higher level. At this precise moment, I'm sitting here, as Hugh Lowe has just said. You are defying Europe by not letting lamb in. That is not playing the rules of the game. Apart from the apple situation, which is very, very serious in this country, you are giving your apple growers support which is illegal under Article 92 of the Treaty of Rome. And the only reason that it hasn't been proved is because there's no bit of paper. In France, you're guilty unless you're proved. It is up to the French. We are accusing them of doing this illegal distortion of the market. It is up to them, under their own rules, to come forward with a bit of paper to say that you are not getting help through Sopexa, right the way down the line, to encourage us to get out. And this is the only Bramley, I think, that's ever likely to see French soil. If we put our cooking apples over there, they'd be turned over, burnt, pushed back. Up to you, Mr. Schreiber. I want that bit of paper to say that you're not guilty, because I know jolly well you are.
No, I'm convinced.
Right the way down our marketing line, it proves that.
No, I'm convinced we're not. I think I'd like Mr. Lagarde, who's a farmer, to answer that.
Mr. Lagarde, you're from the French Embassy. Yes. You speak on agricultural matters.
I would like, you know, we heard some statement. I'd just like to give a few facts, in fact. If you start with France as a general country, we are a net contributor. Until now, we have been net contributor to the EEC. When you speak about French farmers, the French farmer gets £475, well, the last figures, official figures, were in 78. French farmers got £475 a head from EEC. The UK farmers got £1,100 a year. Now, let's see what.
How many French farmers are there?
42,000 apple growers.
Let's start with the apple business. Before 1965, we were one of the largest apple importers in the world. And since then, we become the biggest apple exporter in the world. We did that through a big technical revolution in France. We grow very efficiently apples. In England, the average yield is 5 tons per acre. In France, 16 tons per acre. When I hear about French promotion in the UK, can I say that French promotion in the UK is entirely paid by the exporter, not a penny comes from the French government. When I hear about loans and grants given to the French farmers, and especially to the French apple growers, can I say that they're absolutely similar to what is in this country? There is no dumping of apples in this country, because every apple which comes to this country is bought before it leaves our country by the trade, by the British trade.
Can I interrupt you and bring in Mr. McMurdo McGuinness on your left, who's in the fishing industry, and see how you respond to what he has to say?
Yes, I'm not quite sure whether we're bad Europeans or good Europeans. I was going to say we're bad Europeans because we do not believe that the other EEC members are prepared to make the sacrifices which we have already made and are prepared to make for the future. When we came into the common market, we willingly agreed to let the EEC negotiate with third countries agreements in the hope that the EEC markets would be used as a bargaining counter for new fishing opportunities which we had lost. We were told that the large clout of the EEC would do this for us. The result, of course, has been a complete and utter disaster. We see it round us today. The port of Hull shut down completely, people out of work all over the country, and our fishing industry dying. I consider that our fishing industry, as a result of going into the EEC and being conned in going into the EEC, many, many people are out of work. Our fishing heritage is going to be lost completely. We have 60% of the 560,000 square nautical miles of our EEC pond. 70% of the resource is in that 60%. And what is the result? The agreements which have now been made by Brussels, which are supposed to be helping us, are now helping the French, the Germans, the Belgians, the Dutch to fish in Canadian, Faroe, and Norwegian waters.
Okay, Herr Lotz, the Germans were mentioned there. Let me bring you in. I know you're not specifically concerned with fishing, but with farming, but I'm sure you have something to say on this problem.
Well, first of all, I think that the question which you put in front of us doesn't help us very much. To ask
I wouldn't worry
to,
about it. Nobody's
or to confirm
spoken to it,
that
right.
The British are bad Europeans, I think we must come to the different questions and to the facts. And I think all the questions and the facts which and the problems which are today between the continent and Great Britain are facts which can be discussed if there is will to discuss them. We have had sometimes the idea in the last year that there was not so much will, but I think alone a country like Great Britain or Germany or France can solve the problems in which we are facing ourselves today. And if you look, for example, at the Iran situation, it was a bad policy, which was if one government says we want this and later on its own parliament says you shouldn't do this, you see there is something which is a problem. And these matters are discussed in Europe. And the other partner countries tell you, well, this was bad. And I think there begins and ends sovereignty, you see. If you have signed the treaty, which means you are a member, this means also at the same time you accept this open discussion between sovereign members in this country. And I think this is a spirit which will lead us in future. And with this spirit, I have the hope that we can settle all the problems which are between us in agriculture. For example, take New Zealand. There are possibilities if we want to settle it. The treaty has indicated the line where we have to go, and there are discussions with New Zealand. We can solve this problem if we want it. And I think this is the fact. If the British government stays to it, they sign and they will stick to it, then if we have this general agreement, then we can solve all the problems.
Thank you very much. Mr. Ramage.
6 million unemployed, more than 6 million unemployed. And it's in that context that I think a lot of people are opposed to the common market. They see the food prices, butter, apples, out of the price range of most ordinary people. Nothing being done about unemployment. You can discuss it all you want. But what we think has got to be done is action taken against unemployment. In that context, the Labour Party Young Socialists, my organisation, we're internationalists. We reject the sham internationalism of people like Geoffrey Rippon, who represent a party that's spent hundreds of years working out how to divide and rule throughout the world. On the other hand, we also oppose the narrow nationalism of people like Air Marshal Bennett, the Little Englanders of this world, if you like. We stand for genuine internationalism.
Mr. Carswell,
That can only be based on ending a system which breeds unemployment, food prices, wasting of food, dumping of apples and the rest of it.
All right, Mr.
Carswell.
All right,
solution.
Point made, Mr. Carswell.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Ramage sounds like a virgin who's not quite sure whether she wants to go out on her first date or not. The point is that we have the common market and we have to live with it. That is the Europe of today, and that is the reality that we have to deal with. Yeah, yeah. And the fact is that Europe The common market is not an all-powerful bureaucracy which can dictate our lives here in London and in Bonn and in Paris. In fact, the institutions of the EEC are quite weak in relation to the national government. And the idea, as Mrs. Wickham and Mr. McGuinness and so many others put forward, that somehow or another the EEC is totally responsible for the particular problems in their sector is very misleading. I mean, the fact is that part of the problem facing the fishing industry in this country is as a result of Iceland. And Mr. McGuinness, I noticed, didn't mention Iceland at all. So we have to remember that the EEC is only a part of the problems that we face. And can I just make another point,
very quickly, Chairman?
Mr. Servan-Schreiber talked as if somehow or another that the problems that Britain faces in integrating into the community were peculiar to Britain, and that Britain was the only one that seemed to be breaking the rules, and that she was renegotiating the whole time. Well, if you remember the mid-60s when General de Gaulle boycotted the community institutions for 6 months, if that was not a renegotiation, I don't know what is.
Okay.
And the fact is, and this is my final point, Mr. Chairman, we obviously have broken the rules in some respects. For example, we didn't want tachographs introduced to our long-distance lorries when we knew perfectly well that we were going to join the community. But what about Scotch whisky? In France, in Denmark, in Italy, in Germany, there are discriminatory taxes against Scotch whisky exports. So they're just as bad Europeans as we are.
All right, let me go lastly from the audience to Mr. Ranieri, a voice from Italy.
Well, basically, I would say that the Italians don't understand why Britain is still so anti-European-minded. Possibly you can say that you don't understand why Italy is one of the poorest countries in Europe, with the richest people, or at least the wealthiest standard of living. But why this British attitude? The historic background, yes. But what about this astonishing lack of information about the EEC? Because European communities are not just the lakes of milk, the mountains of butter, even if many British politicians and the British mass media seem to think in this way. Maybe the Italians are more emotional in their approach towards politics, but I think that there is also a more pragmatic approach. And why not, for example, in Britain, a more pragmatic approach towards Brussels? Let's take, for example, the example of the common agriculture policy. Italy has quite clearly demonstrated that it's possible to get money from Brussels to improve its own economy, its own agriculture. And why not Britain, for example?
Can I stop you there, or can you round off very quickly? Thank you very much. I'm sorry to cut you off, but we are nearing the end of the programme, and I'm going to have to ask our two main speakers, if you would take your places, gentlemen, both take them together, save us time, to sum up with 2 minutes each. Doesn't time fly when you're arguing, it might be said. Mr. Rippon goes first. Mr. Rippon, you're first. Thank you.
Well, we've covered a pretty wide ground. I would like to answer, first of all, the points about sovereignty. Must be understood that what we've all surrendered is a degree of sovereignty in certain specified fields. For the rest, we remain independent, and we in Britain have given up no more sovereignty than de Gaulle was prepared to give up for France or anybody else. But we have accepted we must cooperate in certain fields, and that is what we're trying to do. Point has been made that only France, in fact, is in breach of the rules of the community at the moment. I think it's also clear that the British are seeking the implementation of the Treaty of Accession, whether it's the fisheries protocol or whatever. A reference was made to the Dutch helping us. I may say the Dutch were almost the most difficult because they created the fisheries problem and were very difficult indeed about it. But that's the sort of problem that could be solved if you follow the protocol of the treaty and recognize we all have an interest in the conservation of our fishery stocks. But we may all have a different point of view on these things. We come back in the end to what Mr. Geek had to say. That's what it's all about. You mustn't trivialize Europe into an argument about a button mountain. As de Gaulle said to Mr. Malraux just before he died, true, it's Malraux reporting it, we are the last Europeans in what was a great Christian civilization. I think de Gaulle was too pessimistic. But if we do not succeed in uniting Western Europe, then he may be right. And the choice between a united Europe and one fragmented is really, do you or do you not want a one-way ticket to Siberia?
Thank you very much, Mr. Servanschreiber.
Well, in a way, I will agree with Mr. Rippon. You may not be very good Europeans to my eyes or that of many Frenchmen, but you, the British, are our neighbors. You are our friends and our allies. And as Mr. Walter Geacht very, very plainly said, we have built Concord together. And we have very important business links. We have invested in certain British enterprises, and you have invested in French business too. Let us develop those links, get things done together in common, organize a better world monetary system, organize a better energy control system, a common defense, better and more efficient than the present one. On that point, I completely join Mr. Rippon. But please let the Europeans build up their rather young community the way they want it, and do not try to upset the cart. It will be the best way we could all try to preserve our style of civilization, our freedom, and peace.
Thank you all very much, though. We must leave it. I noticed Mr. Servanschreiber said the cart. He admitted the apple cart, which is the rest of the English expression. But you may reflect that win or lose the argument, you've gained an apple tonight. But we leave it there, except as ever to invite you to let us know what you think. Are the British bad Europeans, or perhaps you feel that we are just misunderstood? Let me.